now, sorry, you're just out of luck. Maybe one day you will. But you know there's a lot to be studied and a lot to be said about fear and stress and the relationship to faith. And so now at least you have a few things that you can use to work through as you face fear and stress and very real manifestations in our lives. But let me just begin today this way. And this is the way I began several weeks ago when we started this. Fear, stress, anxiety. Everybody sigh. Ugh. Worry, panic attacks, sleepless nights, feelings of gloom, work dread, apathy. How do we deal with these things? We've learned that we can overcome fear and stress by believing. And this is something that's very, very important to all of this teaching, and we'll come to this again today, is that faith is the thing that is at the core issue when we're dealing with faith and stress, when we're dealing with fear and stress. I'm really, really afraid. Maybe I'm about to fight a giant, and the question is, well then, what do you really believe? I'm really, really worried, as I don't know, I'm not sure where my next meal's coming from, or where I'm clothes, or these bills, and the question is, well, what do you really believe? Because those things kind of come out. And we said that 1 John 5:4 informs us of that because it ties together the idea of overcoming. You see that there? And that appears actually three times. The word victory is the same word in Greek as the word overcomes. It just doesn't sound quite right in English, so it's translated as victory, but it's actually the same word. And then you have the word faith. And so 1 John 5:4 is on your little bookmarks that you received. And I wanted this just to stick in your mind because this is how John writes in his epistle. It comes out again as he writes the book of Revelation, as he speaks to the churches there and those who overcome. But here's our verse. Maybe you could read it with me. 1 John 5:4. Whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Let's try that again. Maybe we'll all try it together. Ready? Clear your throats. Here we go. Whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. It's all about faith. Remember, faith is the key that opens all the doors when you're talking about biblical Christianity. This is to overcome. Now, I want to add something to this. Oh, by the way, does everybody have their little note-taking guide and bookmarks and all those little things? Candy, cup of coffee, snack. Does everybody have everything they need? If you need one of those note guides, would you just raise your hand? Just to make sure. Yeah, ushers, you got everybody. Okay, just wanted to make sure. Okay, I want to add something to this. I decided to throw this in here because we didn't have enough sermons for this series. But I want to talk just for a second about turning belief into convictions. Belief into convictions. And I have this little slide up here just kind of as a visual to help us remember this. We can overcome fear and stress by belief. And belief forms up convictions. Anybody here have convictions? And sometimes you might talk about your principles. Convictions, I think, are a little bit different than our principles. Our convictions are things we will always do or things we will never do. See, I have a conviction about, let's just say this, I have a conviction about church life. I will always get to church, right? I may be really sick or something one Sunday or another, or have to travel or something, but I'm going to get to church. If you look at my life, I'm going to be a person who's in church because I have a conviction about it. Now, there'll be Sundays where I don't feel like going. Can you imagine that? Anybody imagine that? There's Sundays I might feel like sleeping in. My feelings might say something, but my convictions are going to be what ends up making the decision. Are you with me, everyone? This is really important. Because what it looks like is my feelings are going wild and my convictions throw a rope around my feelings. And so, if need be, drag them along. We are people of conviction. There are things we will always do, or there are things we'll never do. I will never do such and such because a belief of mine has been forged into the steel and iron of conviction. You follow me, everyone? Okay. These are things. These aren't just things we believe and kind of hope. These are beliefs that have been turned into convictions. when our emotions are going haywire, when our fear wants to keep us from doing something that we know the Lord wants us to do, our convictions kick in, and we are afraid, but our convictions lead us to live for Jesus anyway. We are worried, but our convictions lead us to live for Jesus anyway. We live by our convictions. These rock solid things that we believe in. These things, honestly, that we would die for. Right? That's how we know when they've become convictions. Things in Scripture that we believe that we would literally die for. We are a people of deep biblical convictions. Things we will always do and things we will never do, no matter how afraid we are or how worried we are. We are a people of conviction. We turn our beliefs into conviction and we use those to overcome fear and stress. So even though I'm afraid and I obey the Lord anyway. You say, well, that doesn't sound like overcoming. That's exactly the definition of overcoming in the Bible. I'm worried, but I live for Jesus anyway. Convictions take over, we persevere, we make it through life this way. So we're going to take just a second. I'm going to ask you to take that little note-taking guide out now and a pen. And I'm going to ask you this question, if you would just take a moment to think about this. I used to have a real fear of, or be really stressed out by, blank, but I overcame it by blank. I'm just interested. This could be something simple, like I used to have a real fear of the dark, right? But I overcame it by continuing to go into the dark, right? But maybe you want to be more thoughtful or more personal than that. Go ahead and jot something down there. I used to be really stressed out by fill in the blank. But I overcame it by blank. Now, I wish we could overcome all these fears and stresses this way, but maybe you have one or two like this. I used to be really afraid of spiders, but I watched Arachnophobia 10 times, and I went into pest control, and now I'm no longer afraid of spiders. Right, whatever it is. We take just a second to write that down. I used to have a real fear of or be really stressed out by blank, but I overcame it by blank. That's the part I'm interested in. How did you overcome it? You got an idea or two? Somebody said, my brain's not engaged. It's too early on Sunday morning. But a couple of you per table are writing. I can see it right now. So let's take just a second and share those with somebody. Say, lean over and say, what'd you put for that one? Just say, what'd you put? And just kind of snoop at their paper, and then they'll begin to tell you. Okay, just take a second, and Jerry's going to play us a little bit of music to give you guys a little bit of privacy. Just lean over and say, what'd you put? What'd you put for that one? I'm really afraid of sharing my answers in church with other people, but I overcame it by deep prayer. When I'm standing at the end of me, in the rubble of my broken dream, and the wells I've dug aren't filling me, and the world I've made's not what it seems to be. My life, your grace, here I exchange. Okay, any interesting answers out there we all should hear that you should share with the class? Yeah, I see some chuckles, so you guys are, okay, it's good so far? Okay. Okay, good. So there might be little simple things that you do to overcome fear and stress, and those are important too, so please share those with people that might need to know your trick. But we can overcome fear and stress by believing. That's been our theme throughout this whole sermon series, by believing. And here are the things we've said so far. We believe in a heavenly country. Everybody say, we believe. We believe in contentment. Would you say, we believe? Right? Contentment leads us to things like practicing a day of rest, knowing we have limits, know when to stop. It checks our ambitions and our workaholicness, and it helps to manage our stress, right? We believe in a heavenly country, which means that all of our stress and fear in this life are temporary, and that helps us. We believe in contentment, and that helps us to sit back and stop and say, this is a good day's work. Stop and reflect on it and be thankful. We believe in walking in the Spirit. Everybody say, we believe. And the Spirit produces things like love, joy, and peace in our lives that help us overcome fear and stress. We noted that the Holy Spirit is not afraid and is not worried. And Paul says, walk in the Spirit, right? We believe in walking in the Spirit. And finally today, this will be the last one, but we believe in providence. Overcome fear and stress by believing in providence. And we could have spent a lot more time, right? We could have talked about overcome fear and stress by believing in prayer, right? We didn't spend a whole lot of time there. I think you guys already know that one. There's a whole lot of other things we could talk about, but I'm going to end it today on this one. Overcome fear and stress by believing in providence. God will provide all the things we need. Is that what the Bible teaches? Let's try it this way. God will provide all the things we want. Is that what the Bible teaches? Is that what the prosperity heretics preach? Yeah, but that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that God will provide all the things that we need. And all the people said, but he always provides it exactly when we think we need it. And all people say, that's a lie. That's not true. He will provide all the things that we need. Now, we're going to go deeper into what providence means in a moment, but right now, let's stick with this simple definition. Providence means that God will provide. You hear that word? Provide for us everything that we really and truly need. Hasn't God always done that? What do you think? I'm going to ask you to do another little segment here. Are you ready? It's time to do something that's good for our stress and good for our ambitions and good for our clamor. And that is to count our blessings. Are you ready to count your blessings? When you're worried and you can't sleep, try counting your blessings instead of sheep. And this goes to God's providence. I want to challenge you. You ready? This is going to require a piece of chalk or a white crayon. So go ahead and grab it. Let's take courage. So take a lot of courage to grab that and get clear off a place for that black construction paper. Now, more than one person can work on that one piece of black construction paper. So there's a Christian thing called sharing, and I want us to share. Okay? So you're not going to be able to do this on your own. You're going to need the people at your table to get involved. So say, throw a crayon at them. Say, here you go. Here's your crayon. Here's your piece of chalk. Ready? Listen to all the instructions, okay? We're going to 45 seconds is the clock today. 45 seconds. I'm going to stress you out. Use that black paper in front of you, piece of chalk or the white crayon, and I'm going to give you 45 seconds to fill up that paper with things you are thankful for. Yeah, you can write, don't start yet, I see you cheaters. You can write one word, right? But the idea is to fill up the paper. Oh, and you have 45 seconds, and by the way, whatever you forget to put on this, you will not have tomorrow. Ready, set, go. Tell the person around you, say, I need your help. I can't do this by myself. Oh boy, 15 seconds left. I'm not afraid.
Did we start at 45? Yeah, see?
Three, two, one. That's it. How did they do? Oh, hold your papers up for everybody to see, unless you're really, really embarrassed. Good job. Good, good, good. You got different categories for yours. Oh, nice. Nice way to share. Good, 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 good. Now, if you had time, how many of you could fill up the paper? If you had a week, how many of you think you'd still be writing in a week? Yeah, probably, right? So if you wrote all those things down, does it help us maybe to focus on the things we do have? Does that help our level of contentment and peace when we stop and look around? Because we have to put things in perspective. There's a lot of people in the world that would love to have, rip off a corner of your paper. They would love to have that corner, right? Overcome fear and stress by believing in providence. Now it's time to do some work. Everybody ready for some work? Take out your little note-taking guide, and we've got some work to do because providence is a big word, and there's a lot in the Bible that contributes to our definition and understanding of providence. So now we're going to talk more deeply about what providence means. And so here's a big definition. Are you ready? Okay, everybody take a deep breath. This is going to stress you out, right? But here's the whole thing at once on the screen. Okay, everybody say, man, I got to do all this work. Let's read it all together. Let's read it all together first, okay? Providence means that God is involved in everything. He helps the good and makes use of the evil. He does this in a way that, one, preserves his creation, two, answers our prayers, and three, brings about his salvation plans all at the same time. You just said it. So the next time, bump into somebody in church and say, oh, I'm just praying for you to believe in God's providence. Oh, what's God's providence? And you go, I'm glad you asked, right? Or you could just pull out your little bookmark. Take your little blue bookmark out, and then you could just show them that. So let me share this with you. Because there's a whole lot in that, and I think we could say even more about providence. But we'll limit it to this today. Before we go any further, let's try this one more time. You ready? Providence means that God is involved in everything. He helps the good and makes use of the evil. He does this in a way that, one, preserves his creation, two, answers our prayers, and three, brings about his salvation plans all at the same time. Let's do this really quick. Ready? Number one. Providence means that God is involved in everything. He's involved in everything. There is the idea that God created the world, wound it all up, and now he sits back and he watches the whole thing play out. Right? That might be some other God that people have created, but that's not the God of the Bible. Our God, the God of the Bible, is elbow deep into all of the things that are going on in the world right now. All the affairs of everything he's created. Animals, angels, people, and plants. Providence means that God is involved in everything. He cares about it all, right? He cares about it all. Here's the second thing. He helps the good and makes use of the evil. There's a lot of time needed for this, but today we won't take all that. God actively helps the good in this world. How does he do that? Well, his Spirit empowers us, right, for good. He dispatches angels from heaven to accomplish missions of good. But God allows evil to happen and makes use of it for his good, doesn't he? Now notice I did not say he causes it. That creates some real problems. We're not going to say it that way. We're going to say God allows it and then he makes use of it. It's a big difference. He allows evil because he has designed the universe to work in such a way that human beings, angelic beings, have a free will. He wants his creatures to choose him freely. If I created you and then forced you to love me, I don't know that we'd call that love. Right? So he created a universe in which these beings were free. And so if you do that, I'm sure one of the angels might have said, you know, if you create these human beings and give them free will, then what if they chose evil? Well, that's a risk that is involved in this design. And do they choose evil? Oh, yeah, within less than a week, right? Evil comes into the universe, and with it, sin and death. Sin and death always go together. Disease, sin, death, the curse that's on the ground, the things that are in the air, this is a result of sin entering the world because human beings could choose. Now, if God is all light and all truth and all goodness, then to choose other than him is to choose darkness and death and evil, right? But that's the choice. This tree or that tree, right? That's the choice. And God built the universe that way so that allows for evil, but then makes use of it for good, right? So here's a passage for us in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Would you guys read this with me? We know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. Romans 8, 28. God makes use of the good things and of the bad things to work out a good plan for his people. He allows for the evil and he makes use of it at the same time. So thankfully he can do that. And he can do it really well and I think easily. Providence is God helping the good while making use of the evil. And then next, he does this in a way that preserves his creation. God does this in a way that preserves his creation. This is important. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. How many of you have seen a bird that just looks so stressed out, worried? They got to take a nap and drink liquor because they just can't make it, right? Life is just too hard on birds, right? They're so stressed out. Consider the birds. Right, take a look at the birds. You look at the birds one day as you're having your cup of coffee and you think, I wish I was a bird. Or maybe you look at your pet, right? We treat our pets like they're human beings, like they're stressed out like we are and they're not. But look at, they're just laid out on the floor sleeping. I wish I was a dog, you know. They're not stressed out. That's the idea. Look at them. They're not worried about the things. They're not worried about their 501k. They're not worried about the things you're worried about. And yet, they seem to have everything they need, right? That's what Jesus is saying here. And you're a lot more valuable than birds, aren't you? Yes, because the Father feeds them. Verse 27, which of you by worrying could add one cubit to stature? I'd like to be a bigger man. I'd like to be a bigger guy. Worry about it. Will that help? Won't even help. It's just worthless. Verse 28, so why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. And if God clothes the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, won't he also clothe you? And then how does Jesus end that? Verse 30. O you of little... The main issue is not your worrying. The main issue is not your fear. The main issue is not your stress. The main issue is your faith. That's why we keep saying we overcome fear and stress by believing. Our faith is what's at issue. And providence means that we believe that God is going to preserve his creation, isn't he? That's what Jesus is saying here. That the birds have what they need, the flowers have what they need. You're going to have what you need, right? And there's a big picture to that. We'll come back to it in just a second. But as fantastic as the movies are, the earth will not end by an asteroid hitting it and destroying it. That makes for great entertainment because we're sick and twisted like that. The earth is not going to end by dragons. The earth is not going to end by disease. The earth is not going to end because the sun burns out. And believe it or not, the earth's not going to end by global warming. That's not. God is going to preserve his creation. He didn't create it so that we've just totally obliterated it. Human beings are wiped out. We've got to come up with all these crazy schemes to somehow keep the human race going. It's not like that. God's going to preserve his creation. That's what providence means. So, everyone, providence means God is involved in everything. He's always involved. He's helping the good, making use of the evil, and he's doing it in a way that preserves his creation. But that's not all. He's also doing it in a way that answers our prayers. Now, this gets complicated to you and I, but I think it's rather easy for the Lord, because how many different people are praying something right now all over the planet? And how many of them, maybe their prayers would cancel each other out, right? Because, you know, you're praying for that good-looking guy to marry you, but then she's praying for that good-looking guy to marry her. So, but somehow, that's, you know, I'm being silly, but there are some things that we're praying for that might not be to the best interest of somebody else, and yet the Lord knows all of them and can manage all of them and answer them his own timetable to keep his promises to us about answered prayer. This is called his providence. We believe in his providence, right? Here's a passage, Philippians 4:19. Would you say it? Read it with me. God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:19. Father God does not answer most of our prayers by miracle. I wish he did, don't you? Like you pray that you're hungry and all of a sudden food appears, right? On the table is all of a sudden covered with a Thanksgiving feast. That would be a miracle. But more often than not, God answers our prayers through providence. You pray for food, the Lord provides a job. It doesn't seem as glamorous, does it? Right? You pray for healing. And oh, I would love to see, you know, the person who hasn't walked in 50 years, now they can just walk, right? Or the arm that had been lost, now it regrows. Or the eyesight comes back. I'd love to see more of those miracles. They seem to be in short supply, at least in the United States these days. But very often the Lord answers our prayers through providence. Oh, there's something called medical knowledge. As if we created all that ourselves, right? As if that science is something we invented. We're just discovering something the Lord built into the universe, right? So God answers our prayers through providence. There's treatments and there's medicine, those kinds of things. But most often, everybody, how many times do you think most of our prayers are answered by God's people? Have you noticed that? How often you've prayed for something and the Lord has answered it by one of his people? One of his people come to you and said, you know, I owned this and I would like to hire you for this. Or I've come to encourage you today. Or I just feel like I need to give you this check for such and such today. I just thought I'd bring you this meal to encourage you today. How often is it that the Lord just uses his people to answer our prayers? How many of you found that out already? Yeah, that's his providence also. He's answering our prayers, working all these things at the same time. So often. One more thing before we move on, and that's this little segment. I want us to reflect on providence, and you have this on your note guide. Are you ready? Just take a little bit of your thoughtfulness. I may not have had it easy. I may not have received everything I've asked for from the Lord, but blank. Fill in the blank. You're sharing your testimony with somebody. You say, you know what? I may not have had it easy. I may not have received everything I've ever prayed for, but I can tell you this, what comes next in those words? Would you just jot that down real quick? What comes next? I may not have had it easy. I may not have received everything I've asked for from the Lord, but I can tell you this. What would you write there? Now let me get a couple of you. Do you mind just saying what it is to us all? I may not have had it easy. I may not have received everything I've needed, asked for from the Lord, but what'd you put? Sorry, Babu. But I did receive his gift of salvation. And what if somebody here was saying something?
I know he loves me.
But I know God loves me. Good, what else did you put? Good. Yes. So I could see him in my history. Yes, what were you going to say, Heidi? Yes, he knows what he's doing a lot better than I do. Good. Any others? Yes, Danielle. He's always given me what I've needed. Any others?
He's always been interested in me.
He's always been interested in me. Yes, Michelle. Yeah. And sometimes we're like, I'm glad he didn't give me the thing I was asking for. Michael. The best is yet to come. Everybody, so let's reason from that. Ready? I may not have had it easy. I may not have received everything I've asked for from the Lord, but I can tell you this, as I look back on my life, He's always been there. He's always provided what I need, and I know He knows best. He's been with me. And ready? Let's do the logic. So I know that I can trust His providence to take care of me in the days to come. Looking on the past gives me faith. I can trust His providence, and He'll continue to do what He's done. Right, here's the next one. He brings about His salvation plans all at the same time. Providence means that God is working out His saving plans for mankind. Nothing can stop those plans. And all the people said, amen. Let me give you some examples. Nothing can stop His kingdom from coming. And all the people said, amen. The Roman Empire could not kill enough of the apostles to keep the gospel message from getting out to us, right? You couldn't kill enough of them. Herod was too late when he sent his soldiers to kill baby Jesus in Bethlehem. Think that was by accident? Not at all, right? Israel, from whom Jesus came, could not be wiped out, not by the Egyptians, right? Not by the Assyrians, not by the Babylonians, not by the Greeks. They just couldn't be wiped out. Jesus would come from this nation that could not be wiped out for that reason. The family of Abraham, from whom Israel came, seemed to be on the verge of extinction. Because after all, Abraham only had how many kids at the beginning? Zero. And then he has one. Right? It seemed to be on the verge of extinction, but Isaac was born, then Jacob, then an entire nation of Israelites from whom Jesus would come. The Bible is a story from Genesis all the way to Revelation, a story of how God always provided for and always protected His special saving plan for mankind. And let me ask you this really important question. Is He done? Is it over? I mean, we all have our wealth and our happiness, and Christmas is coming and lots of gifts. Is He done? How many of you know that like there's a lot of saving plans left? Right? They're still coming. A whole new plan, a whole new world, right, is coming. A whole new life is coming. And He's not done yet. Matthew chapter 6, verse 31. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles seek, or the lost people are after these things. You guys are Christians. You're supposed to be Jesus followers, people of faith. If the world can't see this in you, where is it going to see it? For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. Father God knows what you need. He made you. But seek first the kingdom of God. Seek His kingdom first and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. You'll have what you need. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, because believe me, tomorrow will worry about itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. He knows what we really need in this life. We can trust Him to provide what we really need. But mostly, He knows that we need the kingdom, right? When you say, Father God, I'm so hungry, I really need some food. He's like, yeah, I know you need some food, but what you really need is the kingdom, right? And the sooner it comes, the better, right? You might say, Father God, I'm so stressed out all the time. I just need you just to give me some peace right here in this moment. Just give me some peace. Yeah, I know you need some peace. But what you really need is the kingdom. And the sooner it comes, the better. You know, we think we have all these other needs, but He's got one gigantic solution. And what's that one gigantic solution, everyone? It's the kingdom. Once that's here, think about it. What are you going to pray for then? Right? And the truth is, if I take some time and think about the kingdom and read what the Bible has to say about this new earth under this new sky, and I stop and go, you know what? God, honestly, if you never give me anything else other than the kingdom, you've already been doubly good to me. Like, what else could I ask for? Right? All these other little prayers are answered in the kingdom. So if we ever say, no, wait, I turned this age and then I died and the Lord never answered such and such a prayer. But if you stop and hold on a second, and the next moment you wake up in the kingdom, you have to wait and go, you know what? The kingdom answers all of them. So that's just how He keeps all of His promises. And what a day of rejoicing that will be. So let me finish it this way. Counting your blessings helps us overcome our worries and our stress and our fears, just like you did on those black pieces of paper. The Lord may not take away bad things from our lives. Very often He does not. But that He allows them and is involved in everything means that He has allowed them on purpose. He has not haphazardly, oop, that one slipped through. If it has come into your life and it's a challenge or something hard, we do not say, well, God caused this unless we're really sure. We can at least say, well, He has allowed it, and the Lord doesn't allow anything unless it's something that He has designed, right? So He has allowed it, has allowed it on purpose, so I can look at it that way, and I can be thankful. But blessings show us that the Lord may not take away all the bad things from our lives. Instead, sometimes this is what I think He does. Something really bad is happening, and you and I are praying, God, just take this away. Just take this away. Take the stressful thing away. Take me out of the situation. Take this thing I'm afraid of away, or take that, take me out of the situation. And instead, all the while, he's heaping into your arms something. He's heaping blessings into your arms. Blessings of encouragement, of love, of special times of prayer, of a phone call from another brother or sister in Christ. And He's heaping them up and heaping them up. And you just keep praying, Lord, take me away from the stress. Take me away from this thing I'm afraid of, this thing I'm terrified of. But He's not doing it. But instead you look and He's just heaping blessings on you. All kinds of blessings that obviously we don't deserve. But He keeps doing that instead. And you find yourself making it through. And you've become an overcomer simply because of a whole heap of blessings. You guys, we went through this together a year ago where God did not do the thing we prayed for Him to do. We prayed that He would heal Amanda's body. We prayed for and looked for a miracle, believed in it, and He didn't. And those became the most terrifying days of my life, terror and stress, a lot of stress at the same time, just like with so many of you. And prayed, all of us together, we were praying, fix this, fix this. And the Lord didn't do it that way. Instead, He continued to heap blessings, blessings, and blessings to get us through that time in our life. Isn't that interesting? So that means that this week is a really important week, isn't it? A time to sit back and be thankful, because sometimes that's what He does, is here are blessings. These will carry you through. You're like, I'd rather you just take me out of this. I'd rather you just fix this, but He doesn't do it. Instead, He says, here are even more blessings. So the Lord may not take bad things away from us. I wish that He did. Instead, He may help us overcome them by heaping on more blessings so that we can say, even in the most terrifying, stressful times, you're a good, good Father. That's who you are. That's who you are. And since He is, and we've come to believe that, then maybe there's nothing to stress about. Nothing to be afraid of after all. Maybe you've heard of the God of the Bible, and maybe you even think He's real. But there's never been a time where you've actually called Him Papa, Daddy, Father. But the Bible teaches us this truth. We were enemies of the Lord because of our sin, and we believe on Jesus. Jesus makes us friends with God again. And not just friends, we're adopted into His family. So that the next time something awful happens or we get stressed out, we can cry out, everyone, Papa, Abba, Father. And maybe all He does is one of those things that dads do with their kids. Maybe this is all He does, right? Maybe the swirling craziness never goes away. Maybe the terrifying monster that was chasing you never goes away. Maybe this is all he does, right? And just like you have said, that is enough. And maybe, more than anything, that is how we overcome fear and stress. We started with that at the beginning. Let's end with that. Our relationship with Father God is the key to it all, isn't it? And if that is right, then we can overcome fear and stress. If that is not right, then we are afraid and we are very stressed. So it all goes back to our belief and our relationship with Him. So let's end that way. And let's take some time just to be quiet and ask this question. How is my relationship with God? What do I really believe? I know the things that I would like, and I know the things that I hope are true, but what do I really believe? Am I right with you, Father God? Let's take some time all over the room and just take this before Him in prayer.